God's people were called to live every single thing they did, like you guys. When you're in school, when you have friends, when you have a job, when you interact on the soccer field, every single thing you do, in God's mind, is a way to say to the world, watch what it looks like when you play soccer as someone who is serving God in everything I do.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, there is so much inspiration that we can find in reading the scriptures. Every day, the Bible keeps us growing and learning, and it helps us to be more Christ-like in a culture that's getting further away from God, seemingly. I think God has his plan and he's working it. Never doubt that. But part of the hope of the world is in the hands of our young people today, and we need to continue pouring into their lives and help them to be witnesses for Christ. So we've invited a number of high school seniors from a local Christian school here in Colorado Springs to join us today in the studio with Ray, and we're going to have some interaction with them a bit later. Ray Vander Laan, as many of you know, is a longtime instructor of religion at Holland Christian School in Holland, Michigan. He's a Bible teacher on our DVD series, That the World May Know, which is celebrating 25 years. Ray, that's amazing. Congratulations, by
Thank
the way.
You.
And let me say, welcome to Focus on the Family.
Thank you. It feels like home.
That's good. I mean, 25 years, it's flown by, hasn't it?
It really has. It's actually just starting the 26th.
When you look at that, I mean, I saw also about 10,000, over 10,000 people you have hosted on tours to Israel. That's a lot of people, and you do it 59 people at a time, right?
Yes, we fill the bus, and that's been an incredible adventure to see people discover the location where God placed all the biblical stories and texts, and it's amazing.
It is amazing. Gene and I had the privilege 2 years ago to be with you on that trip, and it just comes alive. And I think the biggest observation I had was how lacking Western teaching is about the Eastern orientation of the Scripture and the Jewish teaching of the Scripture. And that's what you've really seized upon, right?
Yeah, I think, you know, it's easy for us to take a look at Scripture and to look at the truth that's in the revelation of the words. And that's wonderful. And that's how God has revealed himself in inspired words in Scripture. We call it the Word of God. But we don't maybe stop and think as often, why did God put it in the place he did or give it to the people that he was engaged in working with? And what was their world like? How did they think? How did they describe truth? And that's somewhat different than the way we did and we do. It doesn't mean that what we think or how we read Scripture is wrong, but it means that they do it somewhat differently. I say it to students this way. Imagine looking into a room through a window for weeks. You would come to know that room so well, you could describe everything in it. You could see what was there, the furniture, etc. And then if somebody took you and moved you to the other side of the room to look in another window, the room is the same. Nothing has changed. Furniture is the same. All the whatever's there to decorate it is the same. But looking through a different window, you notice different things that you didn't notice at the other window. So the window into Scripture that a Jewish person, let's say in Abraham or Moses or Jesus' time, would be a somewhat different window than we might look through today.
Well, and one of the things that I remember about your teaching there in Israel with you is when something stands out in Scripture, stop and research it a bit. Think about it. Mm-hmm. Like Jesus cursing the fig tree. It just is an odd statement. Yeah. So go into some research about it and really learn more. And that's what I love, again, with That the World May Know What You've Done. Ray, let's go into David. Everybody loves the story of David as a boy and his courage, and you could set that background up, but tell us the teachings, the Jewishness of the story of David.
Okay. Maybe I could give a little bit of context of why that story matters so much in my own experience in life. When we started this project of That the World May Know, that was a phrase I found in David's confrontation with Goliath. He said, I'm going to throw this stone that the world may know there is a God in Israel. And I thought, that idea captures the essence of the biblical story. We read our Bibles, and it's obvious that God created a beautiful world. Sin came and messed it up, and God worked through this whole process to send his son to fix that brokenness and restore our relationship to God. And so we sort of end there. sometimes. At least I do. But God's purpose was not only to save folks because he loved them. God's purpose was to save folks so they could become his living picture of what it looks like if God is in charge of your life. He didn't want only to be able to tell people about him. He wanted other folks to say, ah, that's what it looks like when someone follows God's way. So God's people were called to live every single thing they did, like you guys. When you're in school, when you have friends, when you have a job, when you interact on the soccer field, every single thing you do in God's mind is a way to say to the world, watch what it looks like when you play soccer as someone who is serving God in everything I do. So that motive of living, because I'm saved, that the world may know there is a God in heaven, is the heart of what, in my opinion, a Jewish person would say the godly life is like. And I found that in David, somehow at his young age, and that's the second reason I love that story so much, because the way the text seems to describe him, David is probably younger than you guys. I doubt he was a high school senior. He's probably a high school freshman, maybe a sixth grader. But somehow this kid, the youngest in his family, not important in that cultural family setting, somehow this kid had caught the vision that he was supposed to live that the world may know. Huh. And that just overpowered me. How in the world can this kid know that at that age when I rarely think about it at whatever age I was at a particular point? So that became the heart of it. In fact, I remember way back 25 years ago right now when we were beginning to talk about what should we title this project we're involved in. And I wanted that title because I thought it really captured the essence of why God saves people. And I remember not that people didn't like it, but a little bit of resistance because it doesn't abbreviate well. It doesn't make a nice acronym. It takes a lot of room on your packaging. But I wanted that word that the world may know. Now, there's a second thing, if I may, that I'd love to share about why that David story is so powerful. He's the youngest. So what he's going to inherit when his father passes away, you could put in your backpack. His older brother's going to get everything. That's how it was done in that culture. So David is relegated to being out in the desert wilderness with the sheep. Now, maybe you saw that in Israel. Shepherds, usually boys or girls that haven't married yet, sometimes older women, but usually boys or girls, when they are out with the sheep, they throw stones almost constantly. Just constantly. Once in a while, you'll see a slingshot nowadays. Often it's just throwing stones. But the kids will sit there and throw stones. They don't throw them at the sheep. I've seen them throw them to the right to move the flock to the right or to the left to move the flock to the left. But you throw stones. I've seen kids with a slingshot that could hit a garbage can at 50 yards. Just bang, bang, bang. So when David came to see his brothers, when Israel and the Philistines were face to face, and bring food to them at his father's instruction, he saw that giant and heard his defiant challenge to the God of Israel. And he immediately said, why doesn't somebody do something about this? Typical middle school kid. Why don't we fix this? Why isn't somebody doing something? So he's brought to Saul, and Saul wants to give him armor, weapons, shield. And David says, I don't know anything about them. I don't want to have that. So he takes his stick, goes down to the brook, and he picked up 5 stones. He's a shepherd. And it struck me years ago, not like it did Goliath, obviously, but it struck me years ago that David simply did what he had become good at doing, what he was talented to do, and what he had been trained to do. So I challenge my students constantly, throw your stone. God has gifted you in something. God has given you a love for something. God has opened doors for you, college next year, military next year, a job next year. When you begin to find what your stone looks like, throw it. Don't let anyone talk you out of it. If you try and throw a stone that isn't your stone, it isn't going to work. Hmm. You throw the stone that God has entrusted to you in that situation, and then you do it not so the world may know about you. You do it that the world may know what God is like. So the kid simply does what he's good at. And I think that's a great way of thinking about our role to live that the world may know.
Well, this is Focus on the Family, and today our guest is Ray Vander Laan, a great Bible teacher and the host of the Focus on the Family series That the World May Know. 25 years now of partnering with Ray in teaching the Scriptures and helping us better understand the life applications of the Scripture. And you can find out a whole lot about That the World May Know at our website, focusonthefamily.com/broadcast, or give us a call. Our number is 800, the letter A, and the word family.
Ray, let's move to the story of Daniel. That's another great young person's story. I mean, we've covered David, and there's so much we didn't cover with David, but you gave us, you whetted the appetite about what David was doing and what he was facing. So how many years after David was Daniel, and what was the environment like for him?
Probably about 500 would be a safe number to throw out. There's various dating schemes, if you will, in terms of exactly, but about 500 years later. That's an interesting story to me for some of the same reasons. The word used to describe Daniel's friends means a pre-adolescent or an adolescent. So again, we got middle school kids. We make Daniel's friends college age or maybe early career at 28. These are guys as young as the students sitting in here today, maybe younger than that. These are just kids. And there's an interesting commentary at the beginning, which Westerners don't pick up on. We believe it, but we don't pick up on it. Do you remember their names? They got these strange names.
Meshach, Shadrach.
Shadrach, and Abednego. Meshach, and Abednego. Now, if you look at the meaning of those words, those names, they're awful. Shadrach means who is great like the god Aku. Now, who would name their kid Shadrach unless you loved Ahu? Meshach means, had to look that one up this morning. Meshach means, I will do whatever Aku commands me to do. Now, Aku is the most disgusting, perverted god you could ever find in pagan culture. And he says his name means, I'll do whatever he wants. Abednego means, I am the slave of the god Nabu. Nabu isn't quite as bad a god, but Nabu's not a very nice god either. Now, who would name their kids that? Well, that was not their parents' name for them. We don't pick up on that in the first chapter, they are given Jewish names. Their Jewish names are Azariah, Mishael, and Hananiah. And one means the Lord is powerful. One means I will do what the Lord tells me to. And the last one, Hananiah, the Lord will rescue me. So the story is going to tell us which name will these young kids live up to. Because it's the king of Babylon who gives them their pagan name. Why? Because he wants to change who they are. Your name there wasn't just a nice word like Phoebe. And that's a name because I like that name from the Bible. A name was a description of who you wanted to be. So if the king gave you a disgusting pagan name, what he's trying to do is to get you to turn, to become pagan in your life. So the question is, are they going to live up to their pagan names? Are they going to live up to their parents' godly names? Honestly, I look at these students sitting here in this room this morning, and if you were in my class, so it isn't fair to do to you because you didn't even know me, but if you were sitting in my class, I'd say you guys all have two names. You have the name that describes how God thinks of you. He knows your talents. He knows your heart. He has a name for you, who he wants you to be in life, the stone he wants you to throw, the faith he wants you to live. God has a name for you. And I don't mean that literally like it's on a piece of paper. I mean, he has a description of you. But so does your world. You have a reputation. Other people think of you in a certain way. They describe you in a certain way in their own mind. Maybe you deserve it, maybe you don't. My question is, which name will you live by? You can live by the name of who God wants you to become. Or are you going to live up to some other identity? And the evil one in our world, it's not a pagan king this time, would delight if you decide to abandon your God name and live up to some other title. It's the same dilemma these kids had. And these kids, my Jewish friends, are horrified that we call them Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, because it's like the whole story is they were willing to burn to death not to be those names. How in the world can we possibly call them that? And the answer is, well, we don't read that first little detail, and we're not interested in names we don't know how to pronounce anyway. But that's a powerful moment. Now, in that, the king demands that they live up to their pagan names. And he says, you will worship me. And they say, no, we are going to be Hananiah, Azariah, and Mishael. They don't say it in those words, but that's what it means. We're going to live up to our God names. He said, I'm going to burn you to death. And they said, okay, go ahead. We would rather burn than be somebody other who God has called us to be. So he throws them into this fiery pit. There's some archaeological evidence that suggests that actually was a punishment used, even evidence of places where that may have happened, like Roman Jews' crucifixion. They used this kind of immolation in natural gas fires that came up out of the ground in the land of Babylon. God saved them, if you remember. King put them in that fiery pit. They looked in, and there were four, not three, because there was an angel there protecting them. But then the cool part of the story raises the hair on the back of my neck, because it brings us back to exactly where we started. The next morning, they were still alive. So the king fished them out, and then he said, praise be to the God of Israel, who would protect these young men. And so all of a sudden we discover, they were willing to burn, not just because they were brave or because they wanted God to be happy. They did. They were willing to burn because they wanted the world to know about him. Hmm. And the end product of the story isn't just God saves people in trouble. The end product of the story is if you serve him faithfully, he will be glorified. And that's that whole thing about God wanting to redeem a partner that the world may know. So Daniel's three friends are a classic example where the words aren't actually used, but whose brave action ends up with the world knowing about the God of Israel and a pagan king, no less, praising the God of Israel.
Ray, when you apply it in that way, especially for young people, and I know they're thinking of questions right now, how do you apply it to today's culture? I mean, it's pretty self-evident, but, you know, the regular high school young person that you're teaching at Holland Christian School or the students around us right now, how do they grasp applying what happened to Daniel or David and put it to their own life? Because it's modern now. It's not like then. Yeah. And, of course,
that's so dramatic.
Those are Bible figures.
And they're saints, you know. They're,
right.
You know, we tend to think of them as much more religious and faithful.
Right, not regular human beings.
Exactly.
So how do you encourage students to do that? I mean, I like the idea of knowing the stone God has given you to throw and throw it. Mm-hmm. Don't let anybody talk you out of it. But also, how am I going to be like that Daniel? How am I going to be like that David in my culture today?
I think my approach, and I don't have an answer because I don't think it's simple. I think it's different in every person's life about how you learn certain God lessons. But there are two things that I try to do. One is what we've been doing here, which is to look at biblical stories and catch a glimpse and a vision of what God is up to with David throwing a stone and say, what does that have to do with me? Now it's a less of a leap to say, okay, what is my stone? I talked to a few of you guys before and heard a little bit about college majors and things you might be interested in. And I got just a glimpse of maybe what your stone is. I don't know if you know that for sure, and God may change your mind 10 times before you actually get to the point where you're throwing that stone. He did with me. But once you find it, that metaphor works.
Yeah. Ray, I've got one more question that we're going to move to the students, so heads up to the students to be thinking about their questions. You know, the scripture that speaks to the idea that there's nothing new under the sun. That humanity, it seems, we're kind of locked in.
Amen.
And we just keep repeating the same mistakes over and over again, whether it's building civilizations and then falling to the weaknesses. And here in the U.S., I think we're experiencing that after a long run of blessing. It seems like we're coming to the end of that, in large part because we're excluding God now from every area of the public square. So again, being a teacher using the Jewish lens to understand Scripture, when you look at the culture today, which I believe is probably a repeat of cycles of the years past, and God's heart for us and where we're at in that process, what do you think the Lord's understanding is right now of where we're at and where we're headed? And what do we need to do as believers to lift him up in the culture in a way that draws people to him?
That's the question of the day, I suppose, in a way. And please don't think that I've arrived at an answer, because I ponder that question a lot. A number of reactions. It strikes me that what you've described has been true throughout history, and that one of the things God did was to send Jesus to break the cycle. Because for the first time, you could actually see what it looks like when someone lives as if God is in charge. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father, he said. He did it right. From his moment on, we not only have his example, we have, as he promised, the presence of his Spirit. So it seems to me we need to become much more aware and dependent of the fact that we're called to be this living example that the world may know, and that it's going to depend on that it's going to take a total dependence on Jesus and the presence of the Spirit. Sure, we work for right and good in every part of life. I think we've got to identify the fact that we will always be the minority. That's what history has proven to us. So the power we have is the power of how we live, which when a broken world watches us, they end up saying, I see a bit of shalom, as a Jew would say. I see a life that's meaningful. I see someone who's content in even hard situations. And that draws. That's what Jesus did. He had the power to show up and change the whole world with one swing of his fist. He didn't. He went out and lived a certain way and ate with sinners, cared about the poor, and touched the unclean, and died for the undeserving, and changed the whole world. If we can reclaim that vision of how God wants us to shape culture, I don't feel hopeless at all. And I want to give a PS to that. That's why I teach people your age, because I believe the hope of the future is you guys. Oh, my generation isn't going to quit yet, but it's in your hands. I have a theory, I'm just in the middle of that right now in my discipleship class, that the disciples were probably teenagers, at least some of them. Jesus didn't start with the 60-year-old synagogue elders. He calls them little children. He calls them little ones. In John, he says children to them. If you guys have the vision to throw your stone that the world may know, you will invite others to join you. Some are going to throw stones at you because of it.
That's
but
right.
Some will be drawn to you when they discover what God's way is like.
Ah, that is so good. That is good. Let's move to questions.
Hi, I'm Sam. So, Ray, one of the things we talked about a lot in our Bible class was finding God's will. What are some things that you recommend to find the stones that you were talking about or find God's will?
Great question. In a way, you guys have me at a bit of a disadvantage. When I'm in school and someone asks a question I don't know the answer to, I just say, it's not on the test. And they say, oh, never mind, then I'm not interested in it.
That's how a teacher
there's no
does
test,
it.
I have to address the question. Brilliant question, really, Sam. That is a great question. How do you discover what your stone looks like? I don't have a simple answer to that. I know that's a difficult journey, and you're at one of the toughest places in that journey in life right now, because you have to be thinking about that before the opportunities necessarily come along. You have to be thinking about college or finding that first job or going into the military for a period of time. But with students, I make several observations. One is this. It seems to me that God's leading involves several elements. One, it involves a close relationship with him scripturally, biblically. And so I advise students already, long before they're your age, to make sure that you have regular interaction with God biblically, because often that word of God, which now becomes stored up in our heart, is used at a given moment to nudge us. And David didn't discover, I've got to throw this that the world may know, 10 minutes before he faced Goliath. He had to have been thinking about that years earlier, and where would that idea have come from? So that's first. Second, I think God puts us in a community for a reason. I think others' observations about what your stones are really important. They're not the final word. They're not the decision maker, but they matter because sometimes we may know, we may not realize we have a particular stone, a particular interest, a particular love, until others observe it in us or notice how good we are with that particular skill or thing. The third thing I say to students is this. It seems to me that ultimately, as difficult as your stone may turn out to be at a given moment, it will often, if not almost always, be something you really find you love and are absolutely contented with. One of the struggles I find with people your age is they love something, but they're being told there are no jobs or it doesn't pay enough. And so they find, well, I can't do what I really love because I wouldn't be able to make a living. I think you got to let God worry about that. God's economy is never down. If you've got something that you love and have skill in and an opportunity comes along, I think that's God's way of saying, give this a look. Take a shot. Look at it. Take a shot. Consider this because your stone will always be in connection with where God has brought you in life. David's stone was because he was a shepherd boy. If he would have been an olive farmer, I don't know what he would have done to Goliath because he wouldn't have had the skill with the slingshot. So that's another element. So throw your stone. Try and figure out what it is. But you may discover over time God is going to nudge you and say, well, let's adjust that a little or a lot. I went to college initially to be a lawyer. And I don't know if I'd have been any good as a lawyer, but he found little ways to say some of those skills, the philosophy you studied are important, but I'm going to nudge you. And nudge you. So that doesn't answer your question, but maybe some things to think about.
Yeah.
Thanks,
that's
Sam.
Good. Ray, this has been great. And I want to say thank you for being here. And to all the young people around, thank you for being here as well, for your great questions. And there is so much content here. You're not going to hear it all at this moment, but go to the website, get the CD. We'll do whatever we need to do to get that in your hands. It is a fascinating discussion. Mm-hmm. I'm so grateful to you, Ray, for being here. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm honored to be part of the Focus family. Mm-hmm.
And you can learn a whole lot more about Ray and his ongoing ministry, partnering with Focus to produce That the World May Know. That entire series is described. Each DVD has multiple lessons on it. They're filmed on location in the Middle East, and again, details online at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast or give us a call, 800, the letter A and the word family. Well, on behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back when we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.